Let me just introduce the next speaker, Professor Nils Christian Holmberg from Sweden, who has a long experience in skiing, as you may imagine. And Jose, could you just say a few words about your work in skiing before and your background before you start your presentation?
I've been working as a coach in skiing, also for Olympian kayakers. I'm a director for research of the Swedish Olympic Committee. And in that role, I also work with all sports, but especially endurance sport.
Thank you.
So good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Sound.
Sitten oma taistelunsa ja näin.
One of these mornings, won't be very long.
Natukkassa saa nagu ettepoole ja siin Thomas Alsgaard toob Norrale jälle teatekulla. Thomas Alsgaard on toonud.
I'll be gone.
So the outline for my talk will be talk a little bit about the cross-country skier performance, and then I will finish with training. Physiology, and to especially study cross-country skiing, actually a very Scandinavian tradition. A lot of famous researchers been involved in this, looking at skiers and this topic from different aspects. One of the first studies published in Nature, by that time it was possible to publish in Nature with maximum oxygen uptake, was Six and Janberg, a little bit more than 80 milliliters and 6 liters in oxygen uptake. Follow up by Bengt Saltin, P.O. Strand, reporting maximum oxygen uptake in elite athletes in different sports, showing that cross-country skiers have really high maximum oxygen uptakes. And Björn Ekblom, together with Hermansen, showing presenting results about cardiac output above 40 liters and stroke volume above 200 milliliters. And on the picture here on the bottom, you see Bengt Saltin testing Juan Mieto. It's one of the highest oxygen uptakes ever measured, 7.4 liters. So a little bit they talked about the human engine, and looking at cross-country ski as a good example, a very high VO2 max, high lung capacity, heart of course, and also muscles that were good trained, not only for the legs but also for the arms. And Bengt Saltin, he quite often talked about to have a dual perspective to describe the demands, characteristics, and effects on the body of a specific physical activity and sport, evaluate the range of performance and regulatory capacity of human organs, study exercise as a means of gaining insights into how the human body functions. So that was a little bit the tradition to combine research, scientific research, but also with the increased understanding to be able to give support to elite athletes how they should train. So one of the aspects that is attracting for researchers, and also of course is complex, is the complexity. They compete at altitude up to 2,000 meters. They train at altitude up to 3,000 meters, especially in the summer and during the fall, autumn, for the glacier to get snow. Temperature down to minus 20, the duration, the varying terrain and conditions, the multiple number of sub-techniques in this sport, two major styles, classic and freestyle, and also the varying involvement of the arms and legs. So this is actually not only a demanding aspect for the coach and athlete, but also very interesting from a scientific perspective. So this is a bit video showing the classical techniques with four sub-techniques, mainly four sub-techniques, and the skating with five. And then we can also call that, depending on the velocity, depending on the condition, depending on the inclination, we can also talk about different spectras within these specific sub-techniques. This is a picture from a race, a video from a race in Lillehammer. And this is on the top, on the long uphill. And if we do the same in the laboratory, Anders Schöd again, one of the best uphill skiers in the world, you see the numbers on VO2 and heart rate and ventilation. That's about the numbers that we also get in the laboratory. So it's high physiological load during a race. And very much the pacing for a cross-country skier is to go a little bit faster uphill, because they have the possibility to recover a little bit downhill and also to change between different sub-techniques and varying the load on the muscles. These are numbers for the Swedish and Norwegian medalists at the Olympic Games in Sochi 2014 and the World Championship in Falun 2015. So this is for the champions in the two national team of Sweden and Norway. And for the men's side on the left, you can see the age, the height, weight, percent of body fat between 6 and 11, and the absolute values for VO2 max during the dyno skiing, where you use arms and legs, a whole body exercise. And it's the technique where the skiers reach the highest VO2 max values. They can also do that in some other sub-techniques, but dyno skiing is one of the most safest. And also for relative values. And on the right, you can see the similar aspects for the women. And you see the dyno skiing is about 4.7 liters and 65 to 76 milliliters per kilo body weight. Many racing events in cross-country skiing, and it has developed. And that is also challenging. It has been also a topic for researchers. So from the beginning, it was individual starts and was only on the relay where they were competing against man to man. But now it's changed. So you have shorter events, team and team sprint, pursuit, when you change from classic to skating. And you have also this tour de ski, when it's a lot of races within 1 week, a little bit more than 1 week. And also that they compete against each other in different mass starts. The average racing velocity of different reasons have increased over the years. And to have more specific possibility to analyze the race, we also use different types of instruments, devices. This is a very specific GPS, very accurate. And here you can see distance over a sprint race. You can see the velocity, the track profile, the course profile, and you can see the changes in velocity depending on the track. And this is interesting because in skiing, the velocity profile is very varying. It's not the same the whole time. And if you compare to examples, rowing, you see here in the middle of the graph, just a second. Here, you see the profile of a race rowing in 2,000 meters. You can see the difference in skiing when they change velocity. And also, depending on the terrain, they also change between different sub-techniques. And as you remember from the first two videos, there was a number of different sub-techniques. And here are the results or the data from a sprint race using the skating technique. And you see that the number of transitions in this type of race, which is about 2.5-3 minutes, it's about 20 to 35 times. And then you can compare to triathlon and swimming, where transition is quite often discussed. And during a longer race, of course, it's a larger number of transitions. And it has been important part of the understanding and also training in cross-country skiing to look at transitions. So the velocity is a wide range in velocity, and it's also a wide range in movement frequency in a race, between 40 and 110 movement cycles per minute, compared to a rowing race between 30 and 50. So this is demanding, challenging. Of course, it's a choice for the skier, and it's also something to take into account when you plan training. Example on a deeper understanding, for a couple of years ago, we performed a study, a very invasive study, putting catheters in artery, in the vein, and up also in the right atrium during skiing. And these are the three of the sub-techniques that were used in skiing, diagonal skiing, double poling, and leg skiing. In double poling, it's very much upper body work, as it was recalled before this study. Diagonal skiing is about 80% leg and 20% upper body. And leg skiing, even if it's a movement of arms, is not the propulsive action from the arms, so it's mainly from the legs. So if you look at these graphs, you can see that the VO2, depending on the different techniques, this was the whole body exercise, this was the double poling exercise, and here was the leg exercise. So you can see that at the same similar VO2, oxygen uptake, there are differences in the legs, the oxygen uptake in the leg, in the arms, and it's changing depending on the sub-technique. If you then take back into account what I said some slides before, that during 10K, it's about 100, 150 times that the skier change between these different exercise modes. It's a continuous regulation between putting blood flow. Here's a graph on the blood flow following the same pattern. So regulating, distributing the blood to different parts of the body. And of course, it's very challenging also when you go up to the max here in diagonal skiing to be able to supply and support blood flow to both legs and arms. This type of study, of course, has a scientific high value. You understand more about whole body exercise and working with different amount of muscle mass, about oxygen cost, blood flow, extraction of oxygen, substrates. One of the aspects that we were looking at was lactate, for example. But we have also used this in training because we can see in this on the slides that it's challenging at the very max to support and to have a distribution of blood to both legs and arms at the same time. And so the heart is an important factor, of course, in diagonal skiing, but also that the arms are important in different aspects. This is a schema, a little bit on performance, different aspects that are important. It has been a tradition in cross-country skiing on aerobic capacities. But the later years, we also looked more into several studies that presented data about anaerobic capacity. It was a little bit in the 80s, Paavo Koomi and Norman presented some, they estimated the anaerobic contribution during a race, a traditional race over, I think it was 10 or 15 kilometers. But later studies, Mugin 94 showed that it was already early during a race, quite substantial blood lactate concentration. And this was part of the study that I showed before with catheters, demonstrating that during exercise, it is a high production and also an uptake in different parts of the body continuing during exercise. And these are two examples on later studies. This is a study from Sandbach estimating, comparing uphill skiing with laboratory measurements, that about 40% of the total energy utilized during these steep uphills were actually anaerobic. And this is a study by Losnegård in Norway, and that was more a time trial on a steady incline, presenting data that was about 25-30% anaerobic contribution. So this is about physiology. My background is a coach, but I've also been a chiropractor for 10 years, working on Olympic level. So I'm very interested in biomechanics. And as a coach, I think not only physiology, but also to add biomechanics is important. So we have done something that has contributed to improved performance. This was before Torino 2006. It was double poling, a new type of double poling. That type of double poling, more dynamic use of whole body compared to before, had a higher peak pole force. It was a shorter time to peak pole force compared to the traditional type of double poling, and also a higher impulse, total impulse. So peak pole force, time to peak pole force, larger total force impulse by changing technique, not by changing physiology, not by improving different aspects in physiology, but changing technique. So this will follow up a little bit that we also looked in the laboratory, a little bit intervention by locking the legs, locking the ankle joint and the knee joint, and observing that this was actually giving us 8% higher V to peak and 9% higher V max. So this was used by our sprint skiers, and today is used about not only by sprint skiers, but the development has been that this is also used in traditional skiing. We also looked at this type of different technique in order to previous studies where they didn't really were possible to increase the cycle length until over a certain velocity. So there was leveling off in cycle rate, length, and they were forced to increase the cycle rate. But this technique, it was possible to continue to increase cycle length on higher velocity. And also, this had been followed up by studies from Norway, here using a PET camera, and here another study from Rud, showing the activity and the importance of leg action. And in this sub-technique that was previous talked about as a more upper body technique, more to be able to use a larger amount of muscle mass, has increased the velocity, but also the possibility to use this technique a little bit in steeper terrain. And moreover, larger part of the race compared to before. In skating, the same example has been here in this technique compared to this technique. And this has been shown them by mechanics, cycle length, and also physiological variables, that the poles are very important. And we use that type of methodology quite often, that we add and take away the equipment in order to see the effect in different ways. So I will end this presentation a little bit with training. And everyone wants high performance, world class, and of course, world leading. This is the Norwegian and Swedish national team, a championship, and you see the number of medals, the last two championships, and they have been very dominant. And this is Shishima, a little bit how they train. So you see, it's a large amount of training. The majority of the training is endurance training. It's not as much at altitude. Even it has been championship at altitude, it's about 10%. Perhaps in some cases 15%, but it's not 50% altitude training. You see also that the large majority of the training is low intensity. It's not high and medium intensity, even if because of the large number of training in hour, of course, this is about 100 hours if you take that together, the high intensity and the medium intensity training. In addition, it's a quite a substantial part of strength and power training, and also specific speed training. And if you look at the high intensity training and the medium intensity training, we will have a session tomorrow morning with the interest group for for elite sport. I think it starts 8 o'clock or 8:30, and then we can continue a little bit to talk about training more specifically, because we will have part there talking about cross-country skiing training. But these are some examples how they train and how they perform this training. But a large part of this is uphill, because uphill is important in cross-country skiing. But there are choices in skiing where you can choose sub-technique, you can choose inclination, and of course you can also use speed. And that's a little bit different compared to running and rowing, where they very often compete on level terrain. But in skiing, to be specific, you need to go for where it's most used, and also a little bit where you have the largest gain. And I will also end this presentation a little bit also to talk about strength and power, because as you see on these slides, of course, they train a lot of endurance training. And it can be a little bit surprised that they train so much low-intensity training, but they're also very strong. You can see on these slides the muscle development, but you can also see on these records on two champions from Sweden winning medals in World Championship and Olympic Games that there are really good records in bench press and bench pull, power clean, in back squats. And so it's an interesting combination. But I think that we can continue a bit to talk about that tomorrow if you come to this session in the early morning. Thank you.
Am I on now? Yeah, thank you very much for this excellent presentation and demonstration of how can you combine the physiological aspect with actually helping the athlete to perform better. Some impressive studies on some of the top athletes. We just have possibility for a few questions. Somebody who wants to pose a question? So let me just follow up on the previous presentation, Jose, when we talked about those individual capacities. How much do you actually look at the capacity and do specific type of training for each individual athlete?
I would say in the team, on the training camp, it's mainly group training, but there are also some part that is more individual. If you compare to track and field, for example, I think cross-country skiing is more that they train together, especially in low-intensity training. But it's because we have very close cooperation between the laboratory, to test them in laboratory, and also how we train in the field, we can also adapt, individualize some aspects and weaknesses for them to improve specific capacities.
Yeah. Good, thank you. So we may have one question, yes? And you always have the trouble with the microphones here. Yeah, we have to do better. No, but I can repeat the answer, the question, maybe even the answer. Let's see.
That's better.
Okay. Yeah.
Ruby Otter, University of Groningen. I was wondering, you showed about the new technique that
yes.
The power output was substantially higher. But how about the endurance with that technique? How did the skiers cope with that?
So actually on sub-maximal level, there's no change. No difference in the VO2, but of course on longer distances it costs a little bit more. So if you compare to 5-10 years ago, they were more able to do it on shorter races, but now this is also the technique that they use. Well, there is some sort of variations also during longer sessions and longer distances. And actually, it's part of the development cross-country skiing that if it's not too steep. And if it's not certain very extreme conditions, waxing and so on, they also, some of the best gears are possible to use double poling all around the track. And I think they will see a little bit more about that development in the coming years.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, we may need a bit of help to make sure we get the presentation here. Somebody